Dear viewer, good evening and welcome to Spotlight. With me tonight, Robin Dallarusso. Robin, welcome to MEA.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, Mr. Wiley.
I understand you are running for the 46th District Court. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about it. Yes. But let me talk about yourself.
Okay.
Where do you go to school? Mm-hmm. Which cities you know you're raised and all that?
Yes, absolutely. So, born and raised in Detroit.
Okay.
Northwest Detroit. Mm-hmm. My mother was a school teacher. She taught at Pershing High School on the east side of Detroit. And my father.
I went to Pershing High School.
I'm sure you did. There you go. Yeah. She taught there for 37 years.
Yes.
So, yes, very actively involved in Detroit public school system, yes, in the unions. That was my mother, and my father worked for Ford. So, union guy. He worked at Ford Rouge plant in Dearborn.
Okay.
So I spent my childhood at Dearborn union meetings. Mm-hmm. It was a wonderful childhood. Working class family.
What school do you went?
Yes. So I went to Cass Tech for high school.
Okay.
Middle school and elementary school, I went to some private schools in the area.
Okay.
So Cass was, that first foray into a large environment, but I enjoyed it. And so I left Cass and I went to Xavier in New Orleans for college.
Okay.
Yes, and spent four
and
years
there. What did you study?
Political science, pre-law. That was my major.
That's mm-hmm. good, yeah.
And I minored in mass communications because I thought I wanted to be a news reporter, at first. So, but that wasn't the plan. So I came home and went to graduate school at Wayne State.
Oh, I see.
Yes, and there I earned my degree in dispute resolution, mm-hmm. Which was negotiation, neutral intervention, things like that, how to resolve disputes amicably.
Yes.
And so that experience said, hey, it's time to go to law school. I want to be a lawyer. I think I can serve my community well in that capacity. So then I went to U of D for law school.
I see. Mm-hmm. They're going to advertise with us.
Yes.
So you graduate as an attorney.
Yes.
Okay. Did you practice it?
I did. So when I passed the bar, and prior to that, though, let me say this, Mr. Wiley, I was a law clerk at the 46th District Court while I was in law school. That was my first job in law school.
I see.
So when I graduated,
that was when?
That was in 2004 when I got that position as a law clerk. And so throughout law school, I worked at the court. And when I graduated, I went and worked for the prosecutor's office in Wayne County for a short period of time.
Uh-huh.
And then I left there and went to Oakland County prosecutor's office.
I see.
So public service was my first positions.
How long did you stay as a prosecutor?
Yeah. So total as a prosecutor was about 4.5 years.
That's a lot of experience.
Yes. And actually, I misspoke. Prior to going to the prosecutor's office, my first job actually was with the state of Michigan. I was an assistant attorney general in Lansing.
I see.
I worked there for about a year and a half. Uh-huh. That was my true first job.
Is that with the attorney general right now?
Then it was Mike Cox. He was the attorney general at the time when I was hired in. And I worked for the corrections division. That was where we represented the Michigan Department of Corrections. So it was federal trial work.
Yes.
Okay. So a lot of litigation experience there, which was important for a first, year lawyer.
Sure. Learning experience.
Exactly.
Know. Yeah.
So that's what translated to the prosecutor's office for me.
I see.
And so I worked in Oakland County, and Jessica Cooper was the prosecutor at the time.
Yes. I know her well.
Yes. And so, that job taught me trial skills. Right? Mm-hmm. Because as a prosecutor, you have to go to court, you have to be prepared, you have to do jury trials. So that experience gave me a lot of litigation experience, a lot of it.
Yeah.
And as a prosecutor, I was assigned to the 46th District Court. So that was my second chance at the court. And so when I got married and had my first child, Judge Johnson at the 46th called
Sheila
me and
Johnson.
Said, yeah, sure. Sheila Johnson.
She's a good friend.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
She called and said, hey, do you want to come? I know you just had a baby. Do you want to come back to the court? We have a part-time job for you as a magistrate and research attorney.
Oh.
She knew my work ethic. She knew, I had a good relationship with the court. And I said, sure, that's a nice job that I would want to have. I can raise my daughter, be with my family. And so I went to the court in that capacity.
I see. How long you stayed there?
I was there as a magistrate for 6 years.
Wow.
Yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. But while I was there, Judge Johnson said, hey, we need a deputy court administrator. So I applied for that position and served in a dual capacity. So I was a magistrate and deputy court administrator.
Uh-huh.
Correct.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. For some reason, and we did a lot of interview, judges running for office, mm-hmm. and usually they are prosecutor.
Yes.
Is that because of the experience, the learning, and the court and all that?
Yeah.
Make him ambition to run for a judge?
You know, Wiley, I think it is a combination of learning experience and opportunity in those positions.
Okay.
You know, a lot of people, if they go to law firms, they start out in a very transactional role where they're doing a lot of writing and brief writing. The prosecutor office and government attorneys, you mm-hmm. are thrown in court. You know, yes. you don't have a choice, right? Mm-hmm. You have to be able to handle a docket. You have to be able to think quickly on your feet. So I think government attorneys in general, especially prosecutors, people go there because you get fast experience. Yes. You get exposure.
You are in the court every mm-hmm. day.
You're in
and
court every day.
You see many different, you know, cases, many different issues and all that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So now you are running for the 46th District Court.
Correct.
And why?
Because our community needs it. Okay. You know, the 46th District Court covers Southfield, Beverly Hills,
okay.
Bingham Farms, uh-huh. Franklin, and Lathrop Village.
Okay.
So five cities within yes. that jurisdiction. Uh-huh. And I have been in our community. I moved to Southfield in 2011.
Okay.
And I became a planning commissioner at that time. Mm-hmm. The mayor was Brenda Lawrence sure. at the time.
Mm-hmm. Very good friend of mine. Very good friend of
yes.
mine. She's my baby.
Yeah. yes. And she appointed me to, yes. to the with the city council permission, yes. obviously, to become a planning commissioner.
Mm-hmm.
So that role in Southfield was very instrumental because it's community development,
yes.
right? It's
yes.
really understanding what the community need is, mm-hmm. what types of businesses can come to
yes.
Southfield.
Yes.
So I was actively involved in the community well before I decided to run.
Mm-hmm.
And so now, Wiley, you know, now I work in Wayne County, so I left Oakland County.
So you are in Wayne County now.
Correct. I work in Wayne County.
Assistant prosecutor?
No. So yeah. right now I am the Indigent Defense Services Department Director.
Oh, I see.
Yes,
yeah.
yes. Okay. So mm-hmm. Warren Evans appointed me to oversee
that
department.
Too, and mm-hmm. he was here a couple of weeks ago.
yes. So we know everybody, Wiley.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he appointed me to oversee this department
I see.
That is tasked with reforming criminal defense work, okay?
Oh, I see.
So really mm-hmm. making sure that poor people have effective representation, which is important,
yes, of course.
You know, for our justice system.
Yes.
So it is very instrumental work. We are changing the landscape of Wayne County, but mm-hmm. the community where I live needs me. So yes. that is why I decided to run.
I see. And
yes.
that's, do you have a primary?
No primary.
August 6th is not affecting you.
Correct.
So it's going to be for the general.
That is correct.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
You have opponent, of course. How many people running?
Just two.
Just two.
Yes.
And that, so because it's only two, there is no primary.
Correct.
So the general election will decide.
Yes.
Are you endorsed by any organization or mm-hmm. police department mm-hmm. or prosecutor? Go ahead.
Yes,
tell me about it.
Sure. So, you know, it's interesting because I am challenging an incumbent, but what has been very instrumental, Wiley, is that I have gotten a lot of endorsements. My most recent endorsements, labor unions have endorsed
uh-huh.
me.
Okay.
12th Congressional District Democratic Party has endorsed me. I've gotten the Arab American and Political PAC has endorsed me.
Yes.
Michigan Jewish Democratic Caucus. I've been endorsed. I've been rated outstanding by both the Women Lawyers and the Wolverine Bar Association. And then community leaders, City Councilman Irv Loewenberg, or City Treasurer Ove Loewenberg for Southfield, Lathrop Village Councilman Jalen Jennings, Southfield City Councilman Charles Hicks, Coretta Hogue is a Southfield City Councilwoman. And then a host of others. You know, my website lists them all, Wiley.
Well, you know, honestly, we are endorsed by mm-hmm. the total community.
Yes.
When you mention the African American, mm-hmm. the Arab American, the mm-hmm. Jewish American.
Yes.
That's mean, you know, and Michigan and Southfield as
multi-part of
many ethnic minorities.
Yes.
And that's good for you to be endorsed by those people.
Yes.
Let's go to the Middle Eastern community.
Mm-hmm.
They have different culture.
Mm-hmm.
The way they live, they take care of their children, mm-hmm. their elderly, you know, they are family value mm-hmm. they have and all that.
Mm-hmm.
As a judge,
yes.
Do you understand different culture when it comes to cases in front of you when you become a judge?
Absolutely. And I'll say this.
Tell me what kind of experience you have in this.
Sure. So what I believe will translate very well is that I was a magistrate. And
okay.
So Wiley, magistrates are those individuals, they're quasi-judicial officers.
Uh-huh.
They do arraignments, criminal arraignments, small
yes.
claims, trials,
yes. yeah.
marriages, they uh-huh. do weddings. And so for me personally, I think that's a good starting ground for anybody wanting to be a judge.
That's right.
The reason
because
being-
Because a lot of cases come from-
A lot of cases.
And
not only
different
that,
people, mm-hmm. you know.
And no attorneys.
Yes.
So in small claims cases, right,
uh-huh.
no attorneys are allowed. So this is an opportunity for you to meet the individual where they are, their legal knowledge, their background, their socioeconomic status. And as a judicial officer, it's my responsibility to make sure the people that come before me are treated with fairness, that I have integrity, that I am ensuring that equity is being dispersed in the courtroom. So to your point, for the Middle Eastern community.
And the other thing, minority.
Absolutely. Yes. Making sure that there is fairness and partially in equity, okay? So that people understand the judicial system.
Yes.
They feel comfortable when they come in. Mm-hmm. There may be language barriers. There may be other cultural
barriers.
That's
very important.
Exactly.
Each one have different culture.
Absolutely.
If I don't understand the culture of Italian and deal with Italian, I'm not going to understand the person.
Correct. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so it's important for a jurist to understand that.
Yes.
And be cognizant of those situations when you're in a courtroom. And I can say that for me, even as a magistrate, at one point I was the only magistrate that was rated in a survey as treating an individual, a defendant, with dignity and respect.
Great.
And I think that's important.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Robin, we have the COVID, and the children, instead of playing with their friend in the school, they are at home in one room watching social media and getting a lot of bad things. The parents, probably one of them lost their job, started drinking. The liquor sale went up 25%. Mm. The two things that came out of that is mental health and a drink and drug abuse.
Mm-hmm.
As a judge, when you have somebody have mental health, this guy, he's not, and if even he commit small, like stealing and all that, or do something because of his mental health, how are you gonna treat that?
So I'll say this, if I could, Wally. The work that we do now in indigent defense in Wayne County, what we are implementing is holistic defense. And what that means is that you look at an individual as a whole person, right? You take into consideration their background, whether they have mental health issues, you know, how were they raised?
Because if you throw them with the criminal, it'll get 10 times worse.
Yeah.
Right.
And you know, you want to understand people, right,
first.
So what we've been doing in Wayne County is we've employed social workers who can assist attorneys with understanding the person. You know, what is their background? Why did they start drinking? What was happening in their lives?
Yes.
And this information is very helpful for the judges because now they can understand this person as an individual and not just a docket number. So for me, that's going to translate for me as a judge. I understand that it is important to look at individuals as individuals and not just cases.
Yes. You know, it's better to send them to rehab than send them to jail. In rehab, he might get better and, you know, and be a good citizen. When you throw him in jail, and thanks God, in Macomb County, they have 30 million they invested in jail for the people with the, you know, mental health problem. Before they came and send them to jail, they treat them and all that. How about the drugs? And you know what? In every community, the drugs is increasing. It's increasing, especially with our young kids. So when you get a young kid commit, as I mentioned, not felony, but, you know, something using the drugs, for example, how are you going to treat them?
So I'll say this, you know, obviously as a judge, you have to see what the facts are before you, right?
Yes.
Understand what the facts are, what is the case, and then rule appropriately based on that. But I'll say this. There are a number of programs, especially at the district court level, specialty courts, where you can put individuals in these things, and if they're successful, it is an alternative to incarceration. It can give them treatment options and additional help.
Yes.
I'm a big proponent of that.
Good.
These district courts are ripe for those types of initiatives because it's always the starting point for criminal offenses. That's where the people get arraigned.
Yes.
And so at that level, you can start to do some intervention. With these types of programs.
Yes.
And not just for, like you said, Wally, drugs, but suspended licenses, you know, veterans. You can start at that level.
And your decision is not going to affect the person. It's going to affect his family.
The family, the victims,
you know, the victims
perhaps.
And all
correct.
That, you know, so,
yes.
So you have to be understanding where they come from and when they, why they have this kind of smaller crime.
Yes.
Thanks God, in Michigan, we don't have that, but many places, they get a criminal, a serious criminal, okay? They give him a small sentence. After a year or so, he go and commit the same crime.
Mm.
Okay. What do you think about this?
Well, you know, like I said, depending on the facts and circumstances of each
case. And as I said, thank God in Michigan we don't have much of that.
Yes, but you know, things do happen, and you're right, you know, and as a judge, that is a position that you might find yourself in, right? Where you might have a person who's a habitual offender is what they call, right? They come out and reoffend. And again, I think it's important though, as jurists, that we recognize that first of all, again, fairness and equity and impartiality when dealing with cases is important. And then also, again, looking at the treatment programs and things of that nature that exist that individuals that come before the court may be appropriate for.
Yeah, but again, when you let them go within 1 year to commit the same crime, this guy is a criminal. So you have to send them, you know, to keep them away from the community. So,
you know, there are sentencing guidelines, right, that, that judges must follow. Now, a district court, I wouldn't be dealing with those types of felony cases is what we're really talking about, because that's when sentencing guidelines come into play, is usually in circuit court. But at the district court level with misdemeanor offenses and things of that nature, again, there are sentencing recommendations based on the probation officer's analysis or the social worker's analysis. So again, the jurist has to look at all of the information, right? If it's a habitual offender, what is an appropriate sentence? So these are all the considerations that a jurist would have to look at, but it's gonna be based on those facts that come before the judge.
Then it take me to questions, what kind of cases you're gonna handle at the 46th district court?
Absolutely, so at district court, and especially in 46, you're going to have landlord-tenant matters. So it could be property disputes, it could be tenant evictions, it could be things of that nature. Civil, general civil cases, less than $25,000 would come before that court. So contracts, land contracts. Then you would have your criminal arraignments for felony cases and preliminary examinations. And then for your misdemeanors, you would have, you know, full trials could possibly happen. And then also you would have appeals from small claims. You would have traffic matters. So the district court handles a number of different types of cases. It is the community court. So that's really why, because there's so many things that could come through there.
Finally, give me a half a minute or 1 minute. Why should Middle East, and majority of the people watching us, you know, Middle Eastern community, although there are some Albanian, Macedonian, Greek, because we tackle a lot of important political issue. So they watch us too. You know, why they should vote for you?
Absolutely. So, you know, I think that people should vote for me, the Middle Eastern community, and just anyone in general who falls within that jurisdiction, because I've demonstrated my experience. I have a breadth of it. I've also demonstrated that I treat individuals with fairness and respect. I also maintain the highest levels of integrity. I have a lot of support by people who believe in the mission of having me on the bench as this individual for fairness and equity and impartiality. But I also think because I look at people as humans, right? And that's important.
That's very important.
I also look at people, look at us all as taxpayers, right? And that jurists should have the public trust. They should demonstrate that they have good decision-making skills. But last but not least, they should recognize that they serve the public. And I've demonstrated that throughout my career.
Well, good luck.
Thank you.
And so August 6th is not. So because when I mentioned that, they're going to look for your name on August 6th.
November 5th.
November 5th.
That's
so
correct.
Good luck in your campaign.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate you for having me, Wally.
You're welcome. Your interview, that was my interview with Robin Dillon Russo.
Russo.
She's running for 46th District Court. Not in the primary. It's going to be for general election. But as she mentioned, a lot of experience, a lot of experience. She served in court, she served with civil rights, she served with a lot of organization. And all that, what she served, it's related to the family, and related to all the ethnic minority. It can be before her, if she's a magistrate or working with Wayne County or at an Oakland County court. So you're looking for this kind of person who understand the culture of everybody, who have that experience that that's so important, that experience. When somebody comes in front of her, when she's the judge, she's gonna use that experience because she learned while she had majesty and all that. So please, when you vote, first vote. And I want everybody to go and vote on August 6th and November 3rd. First vote. And when you vote, look for a people who to put in office that they gonna understand us, understand our culture, understand the way we do as a citizen and as a business people. Robin, I think that person. Robin, she's got that experience. So remember her on November 3rd and vote for her. Mm-hmm. Thanks for watching and good night.
Thank you.